years old. And I know that when I was 9 years old, I had a very strict bedtime. Mum will confirm it was the 9 o'clock news. So this must have all happened probably only at about 8 o'clock in the evening, but I was only nine and it was so cold and so dark that night that it felt like the dead of night. So for whatever reason, Dad had to go out to the sawmill that night. And I went out for the spin with him. So just as we were turning in, left off the Stroud Valley Road into the sawmill, the lights of the car hit the big gates there and the entrance into the sawmill. What did we see? Only two guys climbing over the gate of the sawmill, which was a big shock to us to see this in the middle of the night. And actually, they weren't breaking in, they were breaking out. Climbing over the gate at the very moment that we arrived. I mean, the poor guys, it was a very bad time. So we were taken aback big time, but Dad was all action anyway. He turned on the high beams, he leapt out of the car. He looked back at me and he said, "Stay in the car and lock the doors," which I did. So he went bounding over in the direction of these two fellas. And, you know, I was in the car straining to kind of try and hear what was going on. I couldn't hear, but I could realize that there was raised voices and all kinds of gesticulations going on.
I can imagine.
And then pretty quickly, though, the voices kind of lowered down to a more conversational level. Even the body language all softened downwards. I was trying to figure out what the hell is going on. And then, very quickly, it went to kind of hanging heads and slowly shaking heads. I was completely mystified by all of this. Next thing I see, Dad's arm reaching out towards your man, and he shook his hand. And then to the other smaller fella, he gives him a kind of an encouraging little pat on the arm. And the two guys turn around, they go down the back lane to the back road up to the side of the sawmill, and they just disappeared into the darkness. Dad comes running back over to the car to me, and I unlocked it, and he hops in. And so I was expecting full account, full explanation for all this, what was going on. And instead, he got in, sat down, and he was very quiet. And I would even say, stuck for words.
What?
And so, nothing was forthcoming. I was full of questions. I was like, who are they, and where are they gone, and what are they doing, and where is their car, and why were they climbing over the gate? And so anyway, he kind of slowly came out of his pensive state, and he just said, no, they don't have a car now at all. And in that, I was 9 years old, and that made no sense to me at all because, well, everybody has a car, right? I mean, when I thought about all of the families in New Park, the Arrigans, the Delaneys, the Whites, the Blands, the Lynches, everybody has a car. And I thought about my aunts, my uncles, my cousins, like they all have cars. And all of the teachers out in Mum's school, they all had a car. You know, everybody out in the golf club. So it made no sense to me at all. What's he talking about? They don't have a car. But anyway, I let it go because there were much bigger questions to be answered. So I put that one on the back burner. And I was like, but what were they doing climbing over the wire they out here? So then he kind of reluctantly told me what had happened. And he said, that man now, he can't find any work. And we all remember what Ireland was like in those days with the unemployment. So I knew about that. It was always on the news, you know. So he can't find any work, and he has his wife and his four children at home, and they were all sitting at home tonight with their winter coats on in the living room. So I was like, what? Why would they be sitting with their coats on in the living room for? I mean, in our family, the whole thing was when he came in, the first thing he did was take your coat off and throw it on a chair, the back of an armchair or something, and we were always been told, hang your coat up when you come in, don't be leaving it lying around like that. So I knew all about that, but sitting at home in the living room with the coat made no sense at all. So then he said, well, their house is cold, they don't have any heating, you know. So I said, oh, are the radiators broken? Yeah, they need to get the guy out to fix the boiler. And he said, well, no, they don't have any heating, it's not broken, they don't have any money because they can't find any work. So that, in my life up until that point, heat had just kind of appeared, you know. In a cold night, it was cold outside, it was warm inside. And I couldn't see it or touch it, but it was just there. And so this was the first time that I realized that there might be some connection between warmth and wealth, which had never occurred to me before. So then Dad told me that he had taken his eldest son, who was the other fellow that was with him, and they had walked out to the sawmill, and they were stealing firewood from the sawmill when we arrived. So I was outraged at this idea, and I was like, well, why did you let them go? You have to call the police. They're stealing my nine-year-old self. And Dad just said, no, no, no. He said, that man now has enough problems to be dealing with without me calling the police on him. Mm. And he said, and anyway, I can spare a bit of firewood. And so I think at that point in my life, I had already witnessed my dad's big heart and his kindness and his generosity. But that was at home, you know, amongst family and friends and so on. To see it in this circumstance, where not this guy was not only a mere total stranger, he was somebody who was stealing from my father. He had broken into his business, and he was caught red-handed stealing. And by the way, Dad told him to take home the firewood that he found him stealing. And so I realized later, as on the quiet car journey home, and subsequently when I thought back on it, how lucky I was that when I was first exposed at that young age to some of the inequalities in the world, that I got to see it through my dad's eyes and the huge compassion and kindness that we all know of him. And so everybody would like to raise your glass.
Lovely.
I'd like to make a toast to my dad from Dunmanway, West Cork. We're very lucky to have had him with us. We're very lucky to have had my dad with us.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday.